Hello fellow engineers, welcome again. This is in continuation with our web series which is discussing front-end system engineering for radio astronomy, and we have already covered first four videos where we have discussed different waveguide transitions and choke horn. Now if you could recall some part of our very first video, what we have discussed in that post choke horn, as such we could start putting an septum polarizer or an orthomode transducer so that we have two orthogonal linear polarizations or two orthogonal circular polarizations as output into our coaxial connector, which eventually we could connect with our low noise amplifier. But there is a catch. We want to develop low noise amplifiers for radio astronomy, and since we have to catch very weak signals, our low noise amplifiers can't handle high power. They simply saturate. And most possible saturation of this low noise amplifier is due to the mobile interference which every one of us is using in nowadays life. So what can be done for that? We have to design some sort of filter which could eventually chop off all the mobile signals, and then only the signals coming from outer space would enter your low noise amplifier, and with that your receivers would stay in linear region. To do that, we have also discussed in our very first video that we will be using a circular waveguide filter. There are two advantages of using circular waveguide filter in this particular application. One is, any waveguide filter, since has mainly metallic wall and air, the insertion loss of such filters is really low. And this is of course needed because any loss added before your low noise amplifier is going to increase your system temperature. But another advantage of using circular waveguide filter is that since it has infinite symmetry planes, as such it could support many different orientations of the electric field. Or in more systematic way, I could say that a circular waveguide filter could simultaneously support two orthogonal polarizations. So this is the reason why we have opted for circular waveguide technology at first place. But with circular waveguide, what you have is simply a cylindrical pipe, and only thing what you could play with is the length of the pipe and the diameter of the pipe. With just these two variables, can we really create a filter which could reject mobile as high as possible and give a pass band between 1 to 1.6 gigahertz? This is what we are going to cover in this particular video. So to start with, I must say that for any filter design, we first need some sort of specs. And what the specs are in this particular problem? That we want to reject mobile. And how high rejection is needed? Well, basically this is very place specific situation, because mobile radiation and its power varies a lot from place to place, and how long you are from the tower, etc. But we have to make sure that the attenuation to your mobile signals is such that they does not cause saturation to your low noise amplifier. In my particular scenario, we have doing some practical test, we concluded that we want about 35 to 40 dB attenuation to both mobile bands, that is GSM and CDMA, say 800, 900 megahertz and 1800, 1900 megahertz. We want 35 to 40 dB attenuation. And say 1050 megahertz to 1600 megahertz, we want a pass band with, of course, as low loss as possible. With this, one could write down the filter specifications. And if you are studying microwave engineering and electrical engineering associated with it, by using some standard textbook formulas, you could figure out the order it requires. That is, how many sections are needed in particular filter. And any filter design usually starts with a very simple low pass prototype for which you would compute the element values from standard formulas found in most classical microwave textbooks. The next thing what you would do is you would transform a low pass filter prototype which you have just designed into a band pass type of filter prototype. So all your L and C's are basically get replaced with some sort of resonator using combination of series L and C and parallel or shunt L and C. So with this, if you are lucky and if you could find lumped components of the values which you have calculated, you could simply build a filter using lumped components. Of course, it would have some loss because no component is ideal in the world. And it would be also very tricky to find exact values of lumped L and C, which you would found from your basic calculations. Many people have thought about this problem before, so this is not something new. So what they did, that they have transformed this particular bandpass filter problem into a series of coupled resonators. This is also called as coupled resonators using impedance inverters. The theory behind these things you could also find in many good classical microwave textbooks. And this particular topology is very close to a waveguide filter, which you would realize in practice. So what you have here, that you have a constant L and C for each section, so that would form some sort of resonant behavior. And then there is an impedance inverter in between, which decides the coupling from one resonator to the next. Again, this may sound very much theory-ish or lot of jargon in the field, but this is very close to the reality. Usually, this sort of impedance inverters are in practice realized by choosing an iris in waveguide technology. Iris simply means an obstacle, or in terms of circular waveguide, it is some portion of the waveguide where the diameter of the waveguide is somewhat reduced as compared to the standard waveguide. And if you could figure out the equivalent circuit of such iris or an obstacle, it is very close to the shunt inductor. This is also found by many micro engineers before, and the theory about these things can be found in classical textbooks. So this is what we are going to use to develop our circular waveguide filter. I will not go through all the formulas and derivation. I left that as an exercise to you, but I'm going to show you the very practical aspects of it. So just to start with, I will just show you a simple circular waveguide, that this is the diameter of waveguide, so it will have certain cutoff frequency. And as you could see through more, at some point of time, the diameter is reduced to some lower diameter. And again, back to the different diameter or somewhat larger diameter. So by choosing appropriately the iris diameter and the length of waveguide between one iris to the next, what you could design is a waveguide filter. So to say that how this particular obstacle or iris with a smaller diameter acts as an inductor, I will have a simple EM simulation for that, just to show you the basics, and then we will take to the full-fledged filter. So what you could see on the top screen is very simple circular waveguide excitation. This we have already discussed in our earlier video. But from one port to the another port, there is an obstacle in between or an iris of certain thickness. This is similar to what you could see in reality here. And for this, we could compute the S parameters. So if it is a shunt inductor, it would basically pass only the higher part of the frequencies and it would attenuate the lower part of the frequencies. So let's take its S parameters. And as you could see on screen, the red line is basically the transmission from port 1 to port 2, while the blue line is the matching at port 1 or port 2. So you could see at lower frequencies, say between 1 GHz to 1.3, 1.5 GHz, there is a high attenuation to the frequencies, while at higher end, that is about 1.6 GHz, the transmission is very close to 0 dB. So with this simple manner, one could conclude that the iris or a smaller reduced diameter waveguide would act as a shunt inductor. So from there, and with the theory of impedance inverters and coupled resonator filters, we could then do the entire design of circular waveguide filter. And this I have already done, and this is what I'm going to bring next on the screen. And that it is. So now you could see that there are many such sections for which the diameter of circular waveguide has been changed or modulated as a function of length. By doing so, hopefully we could reject the mobile in a very good manner and be able to do radio astronomical observations in a crowded mobile spectrum. So let me bring you the S parameters of this particular filter which I have simulated. And what you see at first is a S21, that is the transmission from first port to the second port, and in this case both ports are circular waveguide ports. So what you could see that in my pass band, that is about 1040, 1050 megahertz, I have very high transmission, very close to zero. There will be some loss because we have to be realistic that we are going to machine it in aluminium, which has finite conductivity. And this one must take into account into filter design. And then there is some ripple, about 0.3 to 0.35 dB in the pass band. So my pass band, what we achieved in this particular design, is all the way from 1040 megahertz to close to 1700 megahertz. And then attenuation to the mobile band, that is important. So let me check that. So if I see a frequency around 950 megahertz or so, 950, 960 megahertz, I have about minus 43 dB S21. It means the mobile at 960 megahertz and below is going to attenuate by at least 40 dB. That's a good number. What happens on the other part of the mobile spectrum? Say about 1750 megahertz or 1800 megahertz. Let's check there. And the levels we got is about 33, 35 dB and so. So with this, actually we will be able to reject both mobile bands well and achieve very low insertion loss filter in the desired pass band between 1050 megahertz to 1600 megahertz. So with that, one should also look at S11, that is the matching of the filter. And as you could see on the screen, the worst case matching is still about minus 10, minus 11 dB at 1621 megahertz, which is kind of little bit out of the desired band. But overall, minus 12 to minus 15 dB of matching on both waveguide ports is achieved in the design. So this is good. I mean, we got the bandpass filter which we wanted, and we could see in our EM simulations that it is rejecting mobile. But then we have to build this filter, and as you could see, the filter is pretty long. It is about 800 mm, and that's quite long, and you cannot do a machining on that large piece of metal in one go. So what we have done, that we have chopped off the filter in different parts and machined one part after another and joined all different parts together. So for that, I could show you the CAD model of just one part, which is on the screen now. So it has male-female type of flanges on both sides, so you could add one part to the next one. And then in between you have irises or reduced diameter waveguide sections which could act as your shunt inductors. So from one iris to the next iris, there is a resonator, and the size of iris or the diameter of iris really dictates the coupling from one resonator to the next resonator. This is how it works in practice. So what you have in front of you is actually one such section of the filter. So it has one input waveguide, one output waveguide, and an iris in between. I hope you see it. And by adding many such sections together, we have our complete filter. So as I have already mentioned, it is 800 mm long. And do you want to see the very fully fabricated filter and its measurement? Stay tuned. I will bring all the sections together, assemble it. As usual, we will have our VNA and we will do a full two-port S-parameter measurements. So stay tuned. Welcome back. In earlier part of this video, you have already seen EM simulations of circular waveguide filter using WIPL-D Pro. And now is the measurement time. And what you see in front of you is this huge bulky waveguide filter. It's actually not that long. The true waveguide filter just starts here with this. I have a tag here with a sticky note and it ends here. So it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sections. And simulation of this we have already seen. So to measure this, we have to make sure that at the input of the filter and at the output of the filter, we have pure TE11 mode circular waveguide excitation. And in order to do that, already we have developed a transition from coaxial cable to circular waveguide. And these transitions and details of these transitions you have already seen in my earlier videos. So now I am reusing those transitions. And of course I need two, because from one side I have coaxial cable, which is first converting TEM mode to rectangular waveguide, and then it is getting transformed to circular waveguide TE11 mode. And exactly vice versa, from circular waveguide mode to rectangular waveguide to coaxial cable. And then port 1 and 2 are connected to the VNA so that we could do standard S parameter measurements. Now this is somewhat tricky measurement, because once we have very long cables, even if I try to do good calibration, always there will be some error. And the loss which we are trying to measure with waveguide filters is very, very close to 0 dB, because practically waveguide filters have very low loss. The only loss which can be seen in waveguide filters is due to the surface conductivity of the metal used. But again, this is low frequency. It's just about 1.5 GHz. So I doubt there will be any loss, measurable loss due to the waveguide sections. But nonetheless, we have to try to do a measurement and verify that if it works with our simulations. So like shown on the screen, our filter, we have seen already the EM simulations of it, but just for the sake of reference, I bring back my simulated S parameters. So what you could see that I have S parameters and they show that my filter starts roughly around 1030 MHz and it ends about 1065 MHz. So what's the reality now? So to check the reality, let me get the bench view software on the screen and we will try to get a zoomed or enlarged view of the VNA's measurements on the screen so that you could do a fair comparison. So what you could see now on the screen that we have typical S parameter measurement, S11, S22, S21 and S12. Here I have made the scale of S21 such that we could have a very close look at the passband of the filter, while the S12, the scale is quite big so that we could also have a feeling of how the stopband looks like. And since it's a completely passive device, the S parameters are reciprocal. It means that S12 and S21 are exactly equal. So let's start with S11. So as you could see, my first marker is at 960 MHz, which is the frequency for mobile transmission. And since this whole exercise is for developing a low noise system, interference immune system for radio astronomy, naturally we should have as high as possible attenuation at the mobile bands on both sides. That is, one is 800-900 megahertz band and second one is 1800-1900 megahertz band. So this is happening clearly that S11 is close to 0 dB at 960 megahertz, while S21 is minus 55 dB, really good number, so that it will attenuate your mobile signals so strongly that they won't reach your LNA or they won't be able to saturate your low noise amplifier. Excellent. Let's see the start of our passband. So at marker 2, which is about 1050 megahertz, we have now an insertion loss as seen from S21 about 0.5 dB. Well, 0.5 dB in radio astronomy terms is quite a lot, because 0.1 dB of loss before LNA would add 7 Kelvin in your system temperature. So 0.5 dB is already 35 Kelvin. But this is not fully true, because what we are measuring is not just filter, but there are transitions from circular waveguide to rectangular waveguide to coaxial cable, and there are dielectrics involved in the transition, there are connectors involved. So what I did, that I just made a through measurement from the connector of the coaxial cable to the another connector of coaxial cable, and I found out that I have roughly 0.4 dB simply comes from this particular setup. So I believe that the max loss is about 0.1 to 0.15 dB of this particular filter. To get an exact number, one has to do a TRL cal on circular waveguide and de-embed all other factors involved. And then what we could see is the true response of the filter. But at this stage, we just want to verify that if our filter is working or not. And it is working clearly. So then later on, there is some ripple in the passband, about 1500 megahertz or so at marker 4 or something. But again, I believe this thing is mainly a result of long cables and all these transition effects and so on. Because even if our transitions are well designed, there is small mismatch at each and every interface exist. At coaxial cable, at rectangular waveguide, at circular waveguide, and so on. And then have a look at the stop band. Say marker 5 is 1.85 gigahertz, which is also very close to our higher end of the mobile band. And there also we have very close to 0 S22 or S11, and our transmission, let me see, is about 35 to 40 dB down. So again, if we talk about higher mobile band, we are going to receive very, very less power to our LNA so that it doesn't get saturated. Most important thing is that if the filter is working fine, it will attenuate all your unnecessary interference from mobile. And it is, for radio astronomy, mobile is definitely an interference or noise. And important thing, another important thing is that by giving proper attenuation to your interference, you make sure that LNA stays in linear region and it doesn't saturate and it doesn't create any spurious responses in your frequency band. So having said that, I believe that this filter is working fine and its simulated result is agreeing very well with the measurements. So when the whole thing goes inside a system, we should be able to see nice interference-free or noise-free band between 1 GHz and 1.5 GHz for radio astronomy observations. So next part after the filter is the polarizer. And in our next YouTube video, we will try to understand how the circular waveguide-based polarizer works and how it splits the polarizations into left-hand circular and right-hand circular. And we will continue with the next part in the next video. I hope by showing this particular measurement to you live, we have demonstrated the circular waveguide filter well. And I hope this video was informative for you. So in next video, when we discuss septum polarizer, I believe I will see you again and you will try to understand more about the polarizers. Till then, see you.